Hey everybody, welcome to Compass Online and welcome to our first week of our new sermon series called Flint and Steel. We're going to be studying the super long book of Philemon for multiple weeks. And if you don't know that that's a joke, Philemon is one chapter and we are going to dissect it together. And it's one that I'm actually really excited about because it's going to talk about this thing that in the church community we call disciple making. We're going to hear more and more about that through our senior pastor in just a little bit. But before we get to that point, I want to encourage you, take this moment, this very moment, and fill out your online connection card. Go to thecompass.net/connection card and let us know that you've been here with us. Let us know what questions you have about the Compass Church. We love to help people know more about the ministries that are happening here online or across any of our 5 campuses. And while you're there, fill out a prayer request. What's happening in your life right now? What is it that you're going through that you want somebody else to come alongside you in prayer to support? We would love to do that. Our staff and team take time to pray for you every week. So take us up on that offer. And one last thing before we get into our singing and our worship portion of our service is that coming up after that song, we are going to be taking communion together. So if you don't have some bread product and juice product on hand or available, take a moment. You can pause if you're joining on YouTube and just grab your elements and get those ready to go. Now, with all of that said, let's take a few moments, get our hearts and minds in the right place through worship together.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. My great high priest, whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands, and my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me.
Have any of you ever had a bad day? I know that's a silly question, but I bring it up because not too long ago here, I had a really bad day. And let's just summarize it with, it involved a septic system and some backup. Won't go into any details, but it just made for a super long day that I carried my frustration about that home with me. And it got to the point where, unrelatedly, I yelled at my son in a way that was not in a kind and correcting way, in a way that I can truly tell you was just out of frustration from the day that I had been having. You know, a lot of times in an American culture, we like to just brush that off of, it was a one-off instance, or you got caught up in the heat of the moment, you were having a bad day. But something struck me. And it was just simply that what I did wasn't just having a bad day. What I did was I sinned. I took something in anger against my son. I rose my voice to him in a way that was not loving, was not corrective, was just the overflow of frustration. It revealed where my heart was truly at in that moment. And my heart in that moment was not connected to a loving and caring God. So here's where I want to go with that. That one instance of sin deserves death. Now that might sound really heavy-handed again, but it's true. Scripture's clear in the book of Romans that the wages of sin, of one sin, means that something needs to die. That bloodshed has to happen. That sounds like really, really bad news. But the really good news mixed in with it is Jesus has paid that penalty on my behalf. Anytime that you have dealt with sin, he's paid that penalty on your behalf as well. If you'll accept it, if you'll confess your sins, if you'll realize that Jesus has paid the penalty that you haven't so that you can be in right standing with God. So here's what I want to do before we take communion. Is just let's take a few really quick moments right now to reflect. What are the areas that we've fallen short of God's perfect standards for us? Take the time to confess that to Him right now, and then we're going to take communion together. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, He took the bread and He broke it and He gave thanks. And He said that this bread represents my body and it's for you. As often as you take communion, as often as you do this, remember me. Let's take together. And in the same way, Jesus took the cup and He said that this cup represents a new covenant in my blood that's been shed and poured out for you. As often as you do this, remember me. Let's take and remember Jesus together. God, thank you that even though we know that we fall short of your perfect standard, and that falling short means that blood has to be shed, that we can rest knowing that Jesus has paid our penalty. He's paid our debt. We can know that our names are graven on your hand, as we just sang, because of what Jesus has done for us. So God, we confess that we fall short. We are grateful that we can be in right standing with you because of Jesus. Each and every day, every moment, let us rely more and more on you. Let us become more and more like Jesus, loving well, serving well. And we do all of this and pray all of this in His name. Amen.
And welcome to the Compass Church and our new series entitled Flint and Steel, Spark Something. Friends, I can't wait for this new series. First of all, a huge welcome to all of you at our Three Rivers campus, Bolingbrook people, Naperville, South Naperville, Wheaton, and online friends. May God use our new series, Flint and Steel, to profoundly mark our lives. Can't wait. Let's start by doing a little history of starting fires. Are you aware of how fires get started? The lighter was invented 100 years ago. So for the last 100 years, you could use the lighter. Before that, there were matches, and matches have been around for 200 years. But before matches were invented 200 years ago, the way to start a fire, you didn't have these, the way to start a fire was through flint and steel. And friends, these two tools were used to start fires for 3,000 years. Do you know how long 3,000 years are when they wanted to start a fire? This is it. And I'd love to show you how flint and steel works. First of all, flint is a stone that breaks off with sharp edges. And for a long time, prehistoric folks would use this as a cutting blade. Well, back in the Iron Age, they started to realize that the two of them together gives you sparks. Now what they would do is they would take what's called char cloth. And char cloth is a heated cloth that's highly flammable. And you put the char cloth right onto the flint where you're striking it in hopes that the spark will fall on the char cloth and get the fire going, shall we? Sure enough, there it is. And friends, as that char cloth burns, I now open this box and take out what's called tinder. Tinder is finely shaved wood fragments that are highly flammable. Put that right there. And then, friends, I take what's called kindling. Kindling is this thinly split sticks, or maybe little twigs. And by adding those, and then a little bit of air, now we're gonna add, after the kindling, big pieces of wood, just fuel, technically it's called, and that's firewood. When that gets going, it burns for a long time. Friends, for 3,000 years, this is how fire was started, with flint and steel. And there's a very powerful theological or spiritual lesson that is seen with the starting of a fire. I'd like to point it out. Here's the point. When I want to start a fire, do I need to try to get a spark on every piece of wood, every piece of tinder or kindling? No. Fire spreads. Therefore, all I need technically is one spark to light one little fiber of tinder. That fiber lights the one next to it. And that piece of fiber lights the one next to it. Then eventually it lights a little strip of kindling. And that piece lights the next piece of kindling. And eventually that lights some of the wood. And fire spreads to the neighboring combustible material. And friends, that's how the gospel of Jesus Christ was designed to spread across the world. It's called disciple making. It's a brilliant strategy that Jesus came up with. And that's the strategy we're going to be studying together in this series, Flint and Steel. Let me show you where Jesus commands this strategy. It's actually the very last words he gave before he left planet Earth. It's found in Matthew 28, verse 19 and 20. Jesus said to his disciples, there were 11 of them left at the time. He said, guys, go and make disciples, which was a little confusing. They're like, no, 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 no. We are disciples. You make disciples. We don't make disciples. And Jesus was saying, no, no, no. My disciples make disciples who make disciples. See, that's the spreading part. I'll read on. Jesus said, go and make disciples of all nations. The vision of Jesus Christ was that his cause would spread through these guys to the whole world. Can you imagine how overwhelming that would have been for these 11 ordinary guys to say, wait a minute, you're leaving us and charging us to bring your message and change the whole world. And Christ would clarify, yes, it can happen through the strategy, the unique and powerful strategy I'm calling you to. It's called disciple making. You are disciples who make disciples who make disciples. In fact, let me read on. Go and make disciples of all nations, baptize them and teach them to obey everything I've commanded. Friends, baptize and teach. That's the find and follow. There's kind of two stages to it. The first stage is evangelism, where you help people far from God become Christians, pray to receive Christ as Lord and Savior. That's what's celebrated in baptism. And then he says, and teach them to follow everything Christ has commanded. That's the help them follow. Help them find is evangelism. Help them follow is discipleship. And yes, we are to help Christians grow to follow Jesus and reflect him in so many ways. Let me just show you, it says, teach them to obey everything I've commanded. What's the last command Jesus gave? Go and make disciples. It's the one he just gave. So teach your disciples to go and make disciples themselves. Do you see the self-replicating effect of disciple making? Friends, in this way, the world can change. Now, I got to warn you, if you say, oh, Jeff, that's your job. You're the pastor. You make disciples. Okay, if I make disciples and it stops there, this is going to grow really slowly. But if I make disciples who make disciples who make disciples, that's where the spreading and the exponential growth is found. So the vision of God is that all Christians are disciple makers. And so let's learn together, shall we, how God can use ordinary people to impact others spiritually and be part of the chain reaction that changes the world. Friends, we're about to study for 5 weeks a book called Philemon. Friends, can you say, go Bears? You know, you gotta be an enthusiastic fan in the good seasons and the bad if you're the real deal. Truthfully, I get so excited watching our Bears and seeing the season kick off this weekend. It's just so much fun. And I have a jersey here going way back when I was a kid. Walter Payton was my hero. He actually lived in my neighborhood when I was really young, and we would see him and he would hang out with us. Just loved Peyton. Well, as it turns out, his number 34, is a very important number when it comes to understanding the power of disciple making. And you may be a little confused by that. So let me explain. The power of disciple making, here's how we see it work. I want you to imagine that I were committed to making disciples at a rate of one per year. You know, ironically, you could say that I'm doing that because I've got about 8 guys in my men's small group and we've been meeting together for about 8 years. So that leads at a rate of about one per year. If I were to do that for the next 34 years, would you be impressed? You'd say, yeah, Pastor, that would be great. You would have discipled 34 guys over the next 34 years. And that sounds impressive, but our task given to us by Jesus is far bigger. It's not to reach 34, it's to reach the world. Here's the key difference that happens when you focus on disciple making and making disciples who make disciples. Are you ready for this? If I were just not to disciple 34 guys, but rather disciple 34 guys who understand that it's not just pastors who disciple, but every Christian is a disciple and to be a disciple maker. Imagine that. And now let's do a little math. In year one, it would just be me. In year two, it'd be me and the disciple that I discipled. But now if both of us start this once a year disciple rate, then in year three, there would be four of us. Each of us would have made a new one. Now, in year four, it would be eight. In year five, 16. In year six, 32. And that number starts to grow to where? In year 34, over 8 billion disciples would have been made. Friends, that's the population of planet Earth. 34 represents how quickly we could make disciples of every person on planet Earth if everybody were to embrace a rate of one per year. Now, is everybody going to embrace a rate of one per year? No. I want to be realistic and acknowledge that that's the ideal, but it shows how powerful this disciple-making strategy is. And that's why we're going to study it together, because God wants to use you to make disciples. And so, let's turn to the book of Philemon. 5 weeks in Philemon. Have you studied Philemon before? Philemon doesn't get a lot of love. It's not a real popular book, but man, is it excellent. And we're going to learn how to do discipleship from this book. Let me read the first part of verse 1. Philemon 1:1, you know, to call it 1:1 is a bit of a misstatement. There's only one chapter in Philemon. It's a very short book. And so when you see 1:1, know that there is no second chapter. Philemon 1:1, Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus. You know, in these letters, it's a little different from how we write a letter. We typically put at the end who the letter is from. But the ancient tradition was that right away, you'd put it up front. This is from Paul. I guess that's kind of how we do emails these days up in the top. We're going back to the ancient way. Paul's a prisoner, probably in Rome. Scholars speculate that Paul spent a number of times as a prisoner in Rome because of his outspoken devotion to the cause of Jesus Christ. This prison time allowed him lots of letter writing opportunity. And one of the people he wrote a letter to was a guy named Philemon. Reading the second part of one. To Philemon, our dear friend. This guy, Philemon, was a dear friend of Paul. In fact, Paul discipled Philemon. In fact, this letter is Paul ongoing in his discipleship of Philemon. And that's what makes this letter so much fun. We have a chance to see in these written words, Paul discipling his friend Philemon. I've always wanted to be a fly on the wall and watch the Apostle Paul make disciples. Jesus was obviously the best, but after Jesus, I think I may argue that Paul was an amazing disciple maker. We see that both from the book of Acts that records his ministry as well as his epistles or letters. Friends, Paul made disciples like nobody else. And so let's learn from him, shall we? This letter enables us to be that fly on the wall and listen in on, if you will, a conversation between these two as Paul disciples this guy named Philemon. Now, I gotta let you know of the main issue that's going to arise, the main discipleship challenge that Paul's gonna make in this letter. We're not gonna get to it today. We'll get to it later in the series, but I wanna bring it up. This guy named Philemon, he was a very devout Christian, but he had one area in his life that needed to change. He adopted the cultural standard of the wealthy owning slaves. Sure enough, he owned a slave by the name of Onesimus. And Paul is going to help Philemon see that, listen, buddy, if you're following Jesus, the slave ownership of Onesimus is incongruent with Christian theology, and you need to emancipate, free Onesimus. That's going to be the central discipleship challenge. We'll get to it. But that's being said, let's look at the rest of 1 and 2, and let's see if we can gain a better understanding of this guy named Philemon, shall we? It says this, To Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker, also to Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your home. Friends, this tells us a lot about this Philemon. First of all, he was married. He was a husband. Scholars say that this reference to the sister Apphia is actually his wife. And so it's understandable why this personal letter, he'd say, hey, also send my greetings to your wife. And then this Archippus, scholars say, is his son. So he's a dad as well. And Archippus is already an adult son. We see that he's described as a fellow soldier of Jesus. And so we've got a guy who's a husband and a dad of a believing family. Now, when I say a believing family, scholars speculate that Philemon actually came to Christ through the evangelistic work of Paul himself. There's a reference in verse 17, we'll get to it in later weeks, where it seems to imply the indebtedness that Philemon had to Paul because Paul had led him to the Lord. I also want to just highlight that this Philemon was wealthy. We know this because only the wealthy owned slaves. Slavery, as it came about, was usually due to indebtedness. Someone would find themselves in so much debt that they couldn't pay anymore, and they'd give themselves and say, all right, I guess you own me. And so it was the wealthy who had control of the money, who lent the money, who had the employees, who could get slaves. And so as we imagine this Philemon, he's prosperous. He's a businessman and he's done well. He's probably worked hard and demonstrated skill and acquired much, including this slave. So you're beginning to get a picture of what this Philemon was like. I'll add one more thing. Though he was a businessman, he wasn't a pastor like Paul. Though a layman, he understood that he was a disciple of Paul and that every disciple needs to be a disciple maker. How do we know that he was committed to being a disciple maker? Well, let's go back to those verses. It says, to Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker. Though he's a layman, he's working for the cause of Christ. He's saying, I'm not an observer. I'm not going to be in the audience. I want to be in the field doing the good work of ministry in the hearts of people. That's one allusion to it. The second is this. Remember, it says to the church that meets in your home. Philemon probably had a decent-sized home, and he said, let's get a church meeting in my house. And Philemon not only demonstrated hospitality, but probably some shepherding leadership over that group that gathered to worship at his house all the time. As a layperson, Philemon said, I'm getting in the game. I'm getting some people. I'm going to gather them at my house, and we're going to study the word. We're going to worship. We're going to pray, and we're going to grow. Do you see his commitment to the cause of Christ and being a disciple maker? Friends, this is a man who got it. Every disciple, a disciple maker. Now, let me pause and just make sure that we can see the many ways this may look in our lives. The challenge is going to be that we embrace this principle and become disciple makers ourselves. And that can take many forms. One of them, just like Philemon, you can host a small group in your house. It's one of the greatest ways to be a disciple maker is to say, Lord, what am I getting involved in? This scares me to death, but let's do it. And friends, being a group leader, it's great ways to disciple. I've actually got two groups. We have one that meets in our house. It's couples. And then I have a men's group that meets in church. I am so passionate about group ministry because I see that it is disciple making at its very core. So group leaders, one. Friends, you can get involved in Compass Kids. If you work with the kids, you're discipling those kids and helping them grow in Christ. With our student ministries, junior high and high school, you can do that and you get put in a group as the leader and you're disciple making with them. Friends, you can do this as a ministry leader. Maybe it's some other ministry in the church, but you're not only organizing those people for ministry, you should recognize you're called to be a disciple maker, to shepherd them, inspire them, and spur them on in growth in Christ. Parenting. You know, the goal of parenting is not keeping the kids alive. I mean, that's not bad to do. I'm working on that myself. But to grow them in Christ, that's the goal of parenting. It's a discipleship calling. I'll throw one more out there. Mentoring. A lot of folks want to work one-on-one with somebody who's a younger believer and say, hey, can we get coffee every other week and open the word and talk about the Lord? You're discipling. I don't know which form it's going to take in your life. I just know that God wants every one of us to be contributing to the spiritual formation of others, to be a disciple maker. Now, you say, if I were to do that, Jeff, if I were to embrace that goal and find some young people or some people who are old but younger than me in the Lord and try to help them grow, what does it mean to help them grow? What's the goal of disciple making? I mean, what am I trying to help them become? And that's what I want to talk about in the rest of our time. What is the goal of disciple making? Turns out we can find some help in the book of Philemon by looking what Philemon had become. He was a disciple of the Apostle Paul. We've already mentioned that. And Paul, being as good as they get at disciple making, we see fruits in Philemon's life. Philemon had grown, he had changed. And the fruit of disciple making is seen in these verses in the person of Philemon. Let me tell you what the three aspects of a mature disciple that I see. I've seen them for a while. In fact, I have a little memento here. I long ago had a brick marked with these words: intimacy, integrity, and impact. I discovered from the scriptures that if you want a balanced understanding of what Christian maturity looks like, or in other words, the goal of disciple making, these three words will serve you really well. Intimacy is our relationship with Christ. Integrity is reflecting the character of Christ. And impact is advancing the cause for Christ. And so you see the three aspects here, and they are so important. And wouldn't you know, these three, as we move on in the book of Philemon, we're going to see that they characterize Philemon because of the discipleship of Paul. Let me show you. The first, it actually is going to go in reverse order. We're going to start with impact. Philemon became a person of impact. That's part of what it means to be mature in Christ. We already saw that in the verse we read, but I'll read it again. Philemon 1, verses 1 and 2. To Philemon, our dear friend and fellow worker. That's impact, friends. He's in the game. He's working to advance the cause of Christ in the hearts of people. And also to Apphia, our sister, and Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church that meets in your house. This, you know, hosting a group, a small group in his home. These are just evidences that Philemon understood that part of what it means to grow in Christ is that the Lord uses you to make an impact. And sometimes when you're discipling someone, you'll realize, they're not committed to making an impact. I notice an absence of, they're not doing evangelism. They're not doing serving in the church. And so maybe you'll get involved with their life and say, hey, can we talk about something? Do you know you've got the Holy Spirit in you? And one of the things the Spirit does is give you a spiritual gift by which you can serve His cause. And maybe you can describe to them various places that they might consider getting involved in the church through service. And friends, through you kind of being a tour guide of serving opportunities, you can help your disciple make a crucial transition into engagement and serving and seeing the joy of making an impact. So that's one of the signs of maturity, one of the goals of discipleship. Impact. The second, integrity. I see that in verse 4. I'm moving on in Philemon here. Paul later in verse 4 says this: I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers. He loved Philemon, thanked God for Philemon when he prayed for Philemon. I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I heard about your love for all his holy people. Let me stop there. I just want to highlight, I hear about your love for all his holy people. Philemon was known for love. He loved the people of God so well. And wouldn't you know, love is one of the attributes, arguably the top attribute, that points to integrity, the character of Christ. Part of what we long to see in our disciples is that they would be changed, that all the sin and ugliness that characterized their character before would be transformed in Christ's likeness, that the sin would be removed, and that obedience, beautiful obedience, where they reflect the holiness and the glory of Christ more and more. And this love for others that Philemon is known for, that's a sign of integrity, of character transformation, of reflecting the very nature of Jesus. So let's say that you're looking at your disciple and you're like, they got a lot of sin in their lives. They got a lot of stuff they're doing that is contrary to the word of God. One of the things you're going to try to help them do is grow. Now, this is sensitive. If you just lay into them and confront them on 1,000 things, you likely will chase them away. So may God give you discernment and wisdom as you formulate your approach. Maybe you just tackle one area of sin in their lives and say, Tom, can we talk about something? I've noticed, you know, how you speak to your wife in a way that I think Christ may want you to grow. And you point out this area of sin and say, hey, let's take a look at what the word says. And what do you think, Tom? Is this something you want to see growth in? And little by little, you can coach them and help them address areas of moral failure in their lives and increase in integrity, that is, Christ-likeness. All right. Well, the one that's third here in the scripture is intimacy. Intimacy has to do with their relationship with the Lord. And I'm going to go back to that verse and highlight the last part of it, which I haven't read yet. Remember, it said, I always thank my God as I remember you in my prayers, because I hear about your love for all his people, and I hear about your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, faith in Christ. Faith is when we are connected to the Lord, when we're depending on the Lord, when we're trusting in the Lord. And this speaks to that special bond that Philemon had with Jesus. He had faith in Christ. He's like, Jesus, I'm clinging to you. I'm trusting in you. And sure enough, friends, we need to help our disciples increase their relational connection, their faith-based connection to the Lord. Maybe you look at your disciple and you're like, I just noticed that they don't seem to go face-to-face with the Lord very much. They're technically a Christian, which means they're forgiven and reconciled, but they're not seeking to build that friendship. It seems that they've got their eyes on other aspects of the Christian life and not deepening that connection of faith. Maybe you can help them with that. Remember, the first of our four priorities is pursue him daily through Bible reading and prayer. And maybe you can bring that up and say, hey, tell me, I'm not wanting to judge or get down on you, but I'm just curious. How much time do you spend reading the Bible? How much time do you spend with the Lord in prayer? You may discover that in great authenticity, they're like, yeah, I don't get it. I've tried, doesn't work for me. In prayer, I don't know, just not my thing. And you could say, well, can I help you grow in your Bible reading and prayer? And you'd be surprised. So often they'll say, well, yeah, if you can help me make that work. And you can guide them to deeper connection, deeper intimacy with the Lord. Friends, intimacy, integrity, and impact. Three signs of spiritual maturity, and again, the goal of discipleship. I found this to be so helpful in understanding balanced Christian maturity. You know, a lot of us get imbalanced. We have a natural bent towards one and a inclination to avoid one. Do you notice that? People have different personalities, and yet all three are a must. I know some Christians who are so activistic. They go to impact right away. Let's make a difference. Let's make a difference. And yet they have little intimacy. Or they have great impact and intimacy, but little character change. They're hypocritical. They're living with a lot of sin. Friends, we need to look at others, and I should say, look at ourselves. Say, which of them do I gravitate towards? Which one do I have a bent towards that I just love naturally? And which of them do I tend to avoid? I'm going to just confess to you, when I was a younger Christian, I tended to not like integrity. I loved intimacy with God. I was just so into His love for me and connecting with Him. I loved impact. I want to make a difference and change this world. But I had a view of integrity that it was like, all these Christians that are into being goody-two-shoes, they love the rules, they're squeaky clean, and it just seemed like an obsession to me with rule-keeping. And then a guy who was discipling me, a professor back in college, actually, he helped me see that my lack of enthusiasm for integrity, I had it all wrong. I should clarify, I didn't want to say I want to lack integrity, no. I just didn't love that aspect of the Christian life. And he helped me see, Jeff, it's not about rule keeping. It's about inner beauty. Integrity, the character of Christ, is about shining with a beauty that inspires the watching world. And he said, Jeff, we live in a dark world, an evil world, where integrity, character of Jesus is lacking. And when His people step into that and grow in it, they shine like a star in the sky. And I'm like, wow, that is important. And he, through discipling, helped me embrace the missing one in my life. And I'm grateful for that, you know. So important, maybe today more than ever, as our culture seems to be going further and further away from God, as pastors fail, man, do we need Christians and pastors to shine with the character of Christ, integrity. So grateful to a guy who discipled me and helped me see which of the three I was not emphasizing properly. May this guide you in your own self-evaluation. And may it guide you as you disciple those God has called you to. Shall we pray together? Let's do it. Lord, so grateful for this book of Philemon, for this glimpse into Paul's discipleship of this man. And we thank you for the fruit of discipleship seen in Philemon. Lord, show us, first of all, personally, are we not balanced in our maturity? Where do we need to grow? Help us see that. And also, God, help us see in those that we're trying to disciple. First of all, God, I should add, call us to disciple someone and then show us how can we help them grow. What area do we need to emphasize to help them gain biblical, balanced Christian maturity? Oh, Lord, move in our church and help each of us step into this high calling of disciple making. Please, Lord. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Friends, I want to just offer this transition as we go into song. This next song speaks of our intimacy with God, that longing to know Him better. It's one of the three aspects, three goals of disciple making. May you sing this, expressing a growing desire for intimacy with the Lord.
The living God, Spirit of the living God, we only want to hear your voice. We're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we want to know you more and more. We're hanging on every word. 'Cause when you speak,
Hey, I just want to take a moment to say thank you for being here today. You know, if you're newer around here and you're not really sure of who this Jesus guy is that we talk about so much, we want to let you know that we've got a resource available for you. Go to thecompass.net/Jesus. You'll find a little bit more information of some of what we talked about earlier with that communion element of our service. And if you have more questions, feel free to email us online@thecompass.net. We'd be more than happy to set up a conversation just to try and answer any specific questions that you have. And I also want to just take a moment to say thank you for giving. Thank you for your partnership in helping us spread the hope of the gospel here, near, and far. And we're really excited because next week we get to continue this sermon series of Flint and Steel, our study of the book of Philemon and what it looks like and means to be a disciple maker. We're going to do that next time we're together here at Compass Online.